Exactly.
Starting with Bhrguvalli.
Hmm. We will start. So, Happy New Year to all of you. Yasmat jatam jagat sarvam Yasmin yeva praliyate yenedam dharyate chaiva tasmai jnanatmane namaha Ishvaro gururatmeti murti beda vibhagine vyomavat vyapta dehaya dakshina murtaye namaha Taittiriyakasarasya Mayacharya Prasadataha Vispashtartaruchinamhi Vyakyeyam Sampraniyate Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryankaravavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastumavidvishavahai Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. So we have completed Brahmananda Valli, the last class. Exactly 1 year from we started. Last year we started on January 5th, Taittiriya Upanishad. So it has taken a year for us to go through the first two chapters. 43 sessions we have had. Today is the 44th session. Taittiriya Upanishad, as we know, has these three chapters. We saw the Shiksha Valli first, and then Brahmananda Valli, which was completed last week. Now we are getting into the third and the last chapter called Bhrguvalli. Now, Shiksha Valli, if you sort of recall, it's all about certain upasanas. We found six different types of upasana. You know, Samhita upasana, Pancha upasana, Hiranyagarbha upasana, in Omkara as upasana. So it was a certain practice of mind, certain practice of concentration of the mind. That was one major part in Shiksha Valli. Of course, Shiksha Valli ended with this grand Anuvaka, last Anuvaka, which is a convocation address, where lots of interesting things which the teacher was pointing to the passing out students. So that was Shiksha Valli. So it's about upasana and certain good concepts of living. All those were part of Shiksha Valli. Then of course we saw the Brahmananda Valli, which is the core Upanishad, which is highly philosophical. So it talked about Jiva Jagat Ishvara Sambandha. How do you connect these three pieces? That is the subject matter in any Upanishad for that matter. So Brahmananda Valli had that. Of course, we had this Pancha Kosha Vivaranam. How the Upanishad was actually taking us one step at a time and asking us to contemplate on a certain aspect of our own reality. And then deeply contemplate and come to a certain conclusion. So that Panchakosha Vivaranam, that was followed by this whole creation process. Soka mayata bahusyam prajayeti satapo tapyata satapas taptva idagam sarvam asrijata. So all those nice arguments about creation, all that we saw. That was also part of Brahmananda Valli. And finally it ended with Brahmananda Mimamsa, a research into unit of happiness, bliss, to what level we can go to in terms of bliss. So these are all the things we saw in Brahmananda Valli. So now the Upanishad is moving to the third part, and of course this third part is called Bhrguvalli for the simple reason that the opening mantra is Bhrugarvaiva Runihi Varunam Pitaram Upasasara. That's how it starts. So it, since it starts with the word Bhrgu, it's called it as Bhrguvalli. Most of these Vedantic texts are, you know, named like that. Shiksha Valli was called so because first mantra was Shiksham Ya Akya Syamaha Varnaswaraha Matrabhana. So it started with Shiksha. In fact, Keno Upanishad is called Keno Upanishad because the first mantra is Keneshitam Patati Preshitam Manaha. That is the first mantra. So most of these they just, you know, name it with the first. In fact, Ishavasya is like that. Ishavasyamidam sarvam yatkintya jagatyam jagat tena tyaktena bunjitaha. That's how the first mantra is. That's why it's called Ishavasya Upanishad. Anyway, so this Bhrguvalli starts with Bhrgu. So they simply, you know, sort of called it as Bhrguvalli. Now, this Bhrguvalli, the basic thing in Bhrguvalli is actually about, see, so far in Brahmananda Valli it talks about Brahman. Now that is abstract. I mean, the idea is interesting. You know, one can take different positions on that. But at the outset it is interesting. But then we also need a way to somewhere go near it. So the concept described in Brahmananda Valli, which is Brahman, and trying to realize that, so it needed a certain kind of a mechanism, a certain way of how to do it. So in some ways, Bhrguvalli is pointing to that. That is how it is. So let me quickly tell you some of the important things about Bhrguvalli. As I told you, it is named because it starts with the, sorry, word, not work. It starts with the word Bhrugarvaivarunihi. So that's why it is called Bhrguvalli. And it has an interesting thing called Bhargavi Varuni Vidya. After six Anuvakas, Saishaba Argavi Varuni Vidya. That's how it ends. So typically they call it as Bhargavi Varuni Vidya. Why? Because Bhargavi is pertaining to Bhrgu. Varuni is pertaining to Varuna. The Varuna is the father actually. Bhrgu is the son. So it's a conversation between the father and the son. And this Vidya is called, there are a few, three, four popular Vidyas in Vedanta. This is one. Bhargavi Varuni Vidya. So that's why it is called Bhargavi Varuni Vidya. And as I told, it's a conversation between the father, who happens to be Varuna, and the son, who is Bhrgu. And also, what you will see in this Valli, in this chapter, is the notion of tapas. Because again and again, every Anuvaka will end with satapo tapyata, satapas taptva. That will come again and again. He will say, you know, adi hi bhagavo brahmheti, we will see that. So there is this repeated emphasis on tapas as a mechanism to really, you know, as a tool to get Brahma Vidya. So one of the most, you know, sought after and recommended tool is tapas. So that is, so as I told, the mukhya uddesha of this chapter is, what is the method to realize Brahman? You describe elaborately all that in Brahmananda Valli, that there is a larger concept and we need to go through the Pancha Koshas and challenge it and so on. How there it is a concept. The knowledge was established there, but here it is, how do you actually do it? How can we go about the job of doing this? So that is why the tapas is coming here. So the mukhya udesha is to show some means by which... Also in this, there are 10 anuvakas, of course, which we will see. Of the 10 anuvakas, the first 6 are Bhargavi Varuni Vidya, the conversation between Bhrigu and the Varuna. So that collection of knowledge is Bhargavi Varuni Vidya. Then there are last 3 anuvakas, which is a nice upasana on annam. It says annam na nindyat tad vratam annam bahukurvita annam na parichakshita. There are 3 things, nice thoughts. Again, there are some sadacharas, because the Upanishad is ending, it is reminding certain elements of good living. I call it more than as good living. To me, most of these ideas that you see, to me, shows up as sustainable living. I wouldn't use the word good living. It is more sustainable living. But today, sustainability seems to be a big issue. There is a certain lifestyle which seems to challenge the very sustainability. It's a lot of thought, there's a lot of multilateral summits and all that happening. Whereas a lot of these principles that you see in Vedantic literature, to me it appears they actually point to sustainable living. So sadacharas, because dharana dharma ityahu, dharmo dharayate jagat. Dharma is the only way by which you create a sustainable world. That is the definition of dharma. That's why if people can follow dharma, there is a possibility of it's a window of opportunity for sustainability. That's the very word dharma has come from there. So all these are in some ways pointing to that. So the Upanishad has all that in 3 anuvakas. Then there is a last anuvaka, which is actually a claim of ecstasy. That student who goes through all these, finally he jumps in ecstasy that I have found Brahmananda, because there is so much of Brahmananda being talked about in Brahmananda Mimamsa that we saw. Teye shatam manushyanam anandaha sayeko, you know, manushyagandharvanam anandaha shotriyasya chakamahatasya teye shatam manushyagandharvanam anandaha. We saw this elaborate piece of units of happiness. So the Upanishad ends with the last anuvaga, in which there is a samagana. It's a ecstasy. It's a jumping in ecstasy that I have actually realized that Brahmananda. I mean, it's a more suggestive thing that it can happen. So that is how the Bhrguvalli ends. So this is how it is structured. The usual Shantipada, it is the same Shantipada, which is Sahana Vavatu, Sahanau Bunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahe. That is the opening Shantipata, both for Brahmananda Valli and the Bhrguvalli, as well as the closing Shantipata. But all Krishna Yajurveda will have only this. The Shantipatas are fixed for the Vedas. I mentioned it in my first or second lecture. I showed what are the different Shanti Mantras for different Vedas. But Taittiriya Upanishad made a slight departure from that. In Shiksha Valli, it used a slightly different Shantipata. But in all other, it is using only the same. Krishna Yajurveda means Sahana Vavatu, Sahana Upanaktu. That is the one which is being used. So, anyway. So, that is the Shantipata. Then the first anuvaka is a question which the son asks the father. And the father gives a very sort of an answer, which you may call it a scriptic. I want to actually talk about it. There is a very interesting structure you find in Bhrguvalli, which is very characteristic of how our ancestors went after knowledge. I want to talk a little bit about that. Today we have no idea of that. We have absolutely no idea of that. I want to little bit talk about it. But anyway, there's a Brahma Jignasa. He wants to know what is this Brahman, and then the father gives an answer. You can do nothing with that answer actually. It looks so abrupt and in some sense. But ancient Indian wisdom, we'll see that, the way it goes and so on. Then Anuvakas 2 to 6 is not the teaching of the Father. Anuvakas 2 to 6 is the revelation of the Son. Father's teaching is over, which makes no sense, honestly speaking. But then the Son discovers a knowledge. This is a very characteristic Indian education. I want to talk about it. We have, somehow we don't know that now. But I want a little bit talk about it. So the Anuvakas 2 to 6 are Bhrigu's revelation, not Varuna's suggestion. He comes with an idea and goes back to his father. But the father repeats the same, you know, half a line, which makes no sense in any case. And then he comes back and then he sort of reflects on it. So that's how those six, but they bring the Pancha Koshas. The same Pancha Koshas which we saw in Brahmananda. But here it is used for Pancha Koshanta Stitaha Brahma Nirupanam. In other words, how do you establish Brahman into these Koshas? How do you, it merely said do it there and then dismiss something as Anatma and then go from there to the other. Here it says how do you do it? So that's what you see here. So Anuvaka 2 is Annamaye Brahma Nischayatva, Brahmatva Nischayaha. Then Anuvaka 3 is Pranamaye, Brahmatva Nischayaha. Anuvaka 4 is Manomaya, Anuvaka 5 is Vijnanamaya, and Anuvaka 6 is Anamaya. The same 5 layers. Only thing is, he is reflecting and contemplating. That is the kind of methodology which Bhrigu goes through. Then Anuvaka 7 to 9 are Anna Brahmopasana, seeing Brahman in Annam. In fact, that's what it is. So Anuvaka 7 says, Prana is food, so do not Annam na nindyat, it says. Then Anuvaka 8 says, water is food. And these are all very suggestive. You'll have to really get a little deeper to, on the face of it, it makes no meaning. Water is food, do not reject food. Annam na parichakshita, says don't reject food. And then Anuvaka 9 says earth is food. And then he says annam bahukurvita, multiply annam. He gives a certain kind of direction to the, to the student. And then the last Anuvaka is a set of sadachara pradarshana. There are some nice code of conduct of living, because the Upanishad is coming to a close. So it remains a few sustainable methods of living. And then of course, as the later part of that Anuvaka, is that Brahmananda Anubhava. Yetat samagayan aste ha uha uha u. Ahamannam, ahamannam, ahamannam. This is a samagana actually. Ahamannado, o ahamannado, o ahamannadaha. Ahaggishlo kakrit, ahaggishlo kakrit, ahaggishlo kakrit. Like that he jumps in ecstasy and, does a samagana. That's how it ends. The Upanishad ends with that kind of a short piece of how he discovered happiness. So that's how the experience of Brahmananda is, in a very figurative way, it is established. And then Upanishad closes down with the Shanti Pata, which is Sahana Bhavatu, Sahana Upanaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahe, and so on. Actually, there are a few very interesting things about Bhrguvalli, which I saw in my own ways, which I thought would be of interest to us before we really get into. Now, if you look at the way this Bhrguvalli has been organized, the knowledge which is being revealed in Bhrguvalli is very, very characteristic of a vast majority of ancient Indian method of learning. That is why I am very keen to little bit talk about it before we actually see it. Now, what would happen, this is our tradition actually, what would happen is, first of all, no learning is imparted, no meaning, most of it, very rarely it may be, For the most part of it, learning is not step-by-step approach. You know, it's not an algorithmic thing. It's not, a cookbook or algorithmic kind of a thing. Most of the learning is not there. Whereas now, a lot of our training is, you organize the knowledge and then put it in a particular way, try to understand what is the first step, second step. Maybe for the kind of knowledge that we are doing, it may be useful. But for the kind of knowledge which they are talking about, perhaps that's not useful. But more importantly, that method of learning may even gainfully be useful on the other side. So the first thing I see is it is not step by step. It's not A, B, C, D, nothing of that kind, which is okay. Then it is not a method. Second thing is very, very important. It is a method of not encouraging any questions. This is so characteristic of ancient Indian learning. Now the point is, because this is very, very different from, now we are told you have to ask questions, you have to clarify and, all that is what we are. Whereas our ancient Indian wisdom has taken a completely different approach. So I keep saying that in the classes also quite often, let's not ask even questions. No, I'm not saying questions are not there. Please understand there are two things. Not asking questions is not saying there are no questions. Of course, I have a lot of questions. The approach is very different. The approach is, I am very personally very impressed with this approach. The approach is, of course, we have questions. When you try to, partake a knowledge, there is a possibility of doubts and questions which may come. Our approach is, you preserve the question. First of all, don't ask the question. Keep the question with you. Because if you keep the question with you and not let it out, three things will happen. I think we'll have our own anubhava on that. Once, I say maybe we have our own experience, also I am only probably connecting it. If you don't ask, you have a question but you don't ask, three things will happen. The first thing that will happen is, after some time, the question will disappear. Disappear for not any other reason. It either got answered or the question, your understanding has gone to a level where you think the question is futile. So you feel probably this question is not quite. Okay. Second thing that can happen is that question will be replaced by another question. So that question invariably will be much more profounder. This question is not disappearing, but it gets replaced with another question. And invariably, that question is much more deeper. But third most important thing is, by choosing not asking the answer, you are committing your faculty to an intense inquiry. And you settle the answer. This is why the culture of not asking, see, that is misunderstood. And misunderstood as don't ask question, you are not supposed to ask question. If you ask question, put them down. It has taken various, particularly in Brahma Vidya and this kind of, self-reflective science and so on. It may be a great idea. See, about 3 years back, I attended a 70 hours of Vedantic discourse from a Swamiji. So I had a lot of questions, of course. I asked no questions. So this Swamiji got so curious. Because these other people are asking, so after a few, this was a 40 days, 45 days. Every day about 2 hours. So 90 hours. Intense sort of a, evening 8 to 10 we'll meet. I used to go and so on. So one day he asked me, what Mahadevan, you don't have any question. So I just smiled. I never told him anything. I don't feel like really, rattling all my thoughts with him. But I had this experience very much there. I got a lot of questions. Of course, I think some of the questions on day 1 disappeared on day 5 or day 7. Some other question made no sense. Maybe that question got replaced with some other question. So this is another very, very characteristic thing. I believe this will be useful on the other sciences also. This is a certain approach to knowledge. This is a certain paradigm to knowledge. The moment you throw the question out, the burden of thinking is now given out. If you let out the question and then give it to the teacher or somebody, essentially what are we saying? The manana will not happen. We have put it out. Now the burden is for you to answer. Now, instead of searching the question, I analyze the answer and then get elsewhere. I see whether this answer is, now I may get slightly diverted. The greatest advantage of keeping the question to oneself is it actually generates a lot of manana. From the shravana to go to manana, don't let the question out. Keep it. Let it eat your mind. That's a great thing that can happen. So this is another tradition which I find. That's why not too many questions are asked. How do you infer it? Look at the first Anuvaka today. It makes no sense what he says. But this boy never asked a question. Chandogya will have a lot of passages like that. Most of the Upanishads will be like that. Ideally, in common parlance, we could have asked a couple of questions and settled it one way or the other. It has not been done. It doesn't mean they understood. It doesn't mean the question does not exist. So that's what, of course, Ramana Maharishi came from a different perspective. He said whenever people ask questions to Ramana Maharishi, he will only ask you question the questioner. So he will put you into another level of thinking. He will say, ask who is asking this question. Now, if you really start asking who is asking this question, the question will disappear. Question will go somewhere. This question will engulf you much more. He used to say like that. But the point is, I think the question, we must preserve the question. And allow it to linger our mind. And in a very unfettered way, we should collect the knowledge. The knowledge, in fact, I remember the first few texts which I read in Vedanta, had absolutely no sense, made no meaning. It was only, divine providence I kept reading. I attended lectures, I kept reading. It made no sense. There was a threshold when it started making sense. So we could easily come to a conclusion, all these are, lot of us actually end up there. Oh, this is all not for us, it is not, we need that perseverance a little bit. Once a threshold comes, things will open up. So this is the second, that there is no culture of asking questions. But then in Bhagavad Gita, he says, Tadviddhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. That pariprasna is not asking question outside. The pariprasna is inside. It is an internal search for an answer when a knowledge is being. So the shravana should go to manana and nididhyasa. Only method is keep the question inside. So that pariprasna is not open question and asking, and that is not the meaning of the shloka according to me. Anyway, the third thing which I find in some of this tradition of knowledge, sharing and learning and all that, is it is very crisp. Very crisp. You will see it here also. Brahmavit apnoti param is crisp actually. At least there was an effort to, in some places it is being explained out a little bit. It is very crisp. At times it is indirect. It is not even direct. It is actually indirect. You ask A, they say Z. And then from Z you have to get A. And if you are willing to go through the journey, the manana and nididhyasa will actually happen. That is the trick perhaps there. You ask for A, they tell Z. It's not really in any ways connected apparently on the face of it. Okay? Or, I have seen a beautiful passage today. I want to actually show another famous vidya called Prajapriti Aruni Vidya. This is one thing which I love to recite. If you recite it, it will take 15 minutes non-stop. There is no full stop in the paragraph. I have to still breathe in between. But it's so beautiful. I will recite it today. Yeah, there is a word file which I have opened already. At that time, we will take it. Because that will show this fourth method. So let me go to this Prajapati Aruni Vidya. It's beautiful in Mahanarayana Upanishad, which is one chapter, three chapters before this Taittiriya Upanishad in Taittiriya Aranyaka. It's a beautiful mantra. I will recite that. Look at the charm of what they are saying. So let me just take you through this. Okay. So let me recite. It's very long, so let me first recite it. Then I'll quickly tell you what it is. Prajapatyo haruni suparneya prajapatim pitaramupasasarakim bhagavanta paramam vadantiti Tasmai provacha satyena vayuravati satyena ditye rochate divi satyam vacha pratishta satye sarvam pratishtitam tasmaat satyam paramam vadanti tapasa deva devata magra ayantapasarshaya suvaranvavindan tapasa sapatnan pranudamarati stapasi sarvam pratishtitam tasma tapaparamam vadanti damena danta kilbishamavadunvanti damena brahmacharina suvaragachandame damo bhutana am duradarsham dame sarvam pratishtitam tasmad damaparamam vadanti shamena shanta shivamacharanti shamena nakam munayonvavindan chamo bhutana am duradarshachame sarvam pratishtitam tasmad chamaparamam vadanti danam yajnanam varutam dakshina loke dataragum sarva bhutan upajivanti dane narati rapanudanta danena dvishanto mitra bhavanti dane sarvam pratishtitam tasma adanam paramam vadanti dharmo vishvasya jagata pratishta loke dharmishtam praja upasarpanti dharmena papam apunudati dharme sarvam pratishtitam tasma adharmam paramam vadanti prajananam vai pratishta loke sadhu prajaya tantum tanvana pitrinam anrino bhavati tade devatasya anrinam tasmaat prajananam paramam vadantyagnayo vaitrayi vidya devayana panta garhapatyar prithivi ratantaramanvaharya pachanam yajurantariksham vamadevya mahavaniya sama suvargo loko brihastasmadagnin paramam vadantyagni hotragum sayam pratar grihanam nishkritis swishtagum suhrutam yajnyakratunam prayanagum suvargasya lokasya jyotistasmad agnihotram paramam vadanti yajnayiti yajnenai deva divam gata yajnena asuranapanudanta yajnena dvishanto mitra bhavanti yajne sarvam pratishtitam tasmaat yajnam paramam vadantam manasacha prajapatyam pavitram manasena manasa sadhu pashyati manasa rishaya praja asrijanta manase sarvam pratishtitam tasmaat manasam paramam vadanti nyasa ityahur manishino brahmanam brahma vishvakatamasvayambhu prajapati sambhasara iti sambhasaro savaditya sa esha. I'll stop here. He says 7-8 things. From there he is moving to ear and sun now. He is moved somewhere now.
Adityo ya esha adityye purushasa parameshti brahmatma yabhiradityastapati.
Now he is saying why I am bringing sun. This is a beautiful piece I quoted once.
Yabhiradityastapati rashmi bistabhi parjanyo varshati parjanyena ushadi vanaspataya prajayanta oshadi vanaspati birannam bhavatyanyena prana prane balam balena tapastapasa shraddha shraddhaya meda medaya manisha manishaya mano manasa shanti shantya chittam chittena smritigum smritya smaragum smarena vijnanam vijnanena atmanam vedayati.
From sun he says you'll know your atma. He gives a whole lot of roots through which he comes there.
Atmanam vedayati tasmadannam dadan sarvaan yetani dadatyannaat prana bhavanti bhutanaam prane mano manasascha vijnanam vijnanadanando brahmayoni savayesha purusha panchada panchatma yena sarvamidam protam prithivi chantarikshancha dyaucha dishaschantara dishascha savai sarvamidam jagasa bhutan samadbhavyam jignasa kluptar tajara ishta shraddha satyo mahaswan tapaso parishta jnatvatam evam manasa hridacha bhuyona mrityum upayahi vidvan tasma anyasam esham tapasam atiriktam ahurva suran vo bibhurasi Prano Tvamasi Sandhata Brahman Tvamasi Vishvadrutte Jodas Tvamasi Agnirasi Varchodas Tvamasi Suryasya Dhyumnodas Tvamasi Chandramasa Upayama Grihitosi Brahmano Otvamagasa Omityatmanam Yunji Tatvai Mahopanishadam Devanam Gukhyam ya evam veda brahmano mahimanam apnoti tasmaat brahmano mahimanam ityupanishat.
This is one paragraph. Non-stop actually. I stopped in between. So question was very simple. The question was Prajapati. Prajapatyaha Haruni Suparneyaha Prajapatim Pitaram. So here Aruni is the son, Prajapati is the father. Pitaram Prajapatim, Upasasara, he went to him. And Kim Bhagavan, please tell me, Paramam Vadan, what is ultimate? Please tell me what is ultimate. This was a question. For which he has given a 4-page answer. Actually. So first he establishes a few things. He first says that Satya is ultimate. Satyam is ultimate. Then he says Tapas is ultimate. Then he says Dhamma is ultimate, which is sense control. Then he says Shama is ultimate, your internal control. Then he says Dhanam is ultimate, your ability to give. He says that is ultimate. Then he says Dharma is ultimate. You know, he gives reason. He says the world survives only because of Dharma. That's what he says. Visvasya Jagata Pratishta. This whole world will remain only if you are able to follow Dharma. Otherwise, unsustainability, all that. Everything is explained. There is a reason why he says that is important. Then he says Prajananam is important. If progeny is not there, the world will come to an end. So that's why it is important. Pitrinam Atrina, you know, Andrina, you know, you have to sort out that debt that you have for your parents and so on, all that he says. Then he says, after that, he says Agni is important. Then he says Agni Hotra is important. Then Yajna is important. Then after saying all these, he says, from there he switches to sun is important. From there he says, if you keep doing it, you are born, you do all that, time passes by, you find that sun is behind all these. Then he says, why sun is important? There he says, Yabihi Aditya Stapati. As long as the sun shines, rain will happen. If rain happens, plant kingdom will come. If plant kingdom will come, food will come. If food comes, you will eat and you will have actually vitality. So all that is there. Oshadi Vanaspati Annam. Bhavati Annena Pranaha. Your vitality is a function of food. Pranaha Balam. Balena Tapaha. If you want to do tapas, you need a physical strength to do tapas. So then Shraddha will come. From Shraddha you get Medha. From Medha you get Manisha. All that he says. From that you will understand the question that you asked. The question that you asked, if you had to understand, you had to go through all these routes. Like this it goes on. And therefore he says, your ability to discover the final truth, he links it to your ability to have food. Food gives you the strength, gives you the physical vitality, mental vitality, concentration. So therefore food is a very, very important thing. Of that you will reach and then find out that what you are looking at is within yourself. That's how the whole four pages of discussion. I mean, this requires a very detailed explanation. So this is another method. You go to A to B, B to C and create a whole chain of events and then leave it. And now each one has to be contemplated. Each paragraph has to be, it looks very unrelated. And then he is still saying at the end it makes a difference. So the burden of manana, the burden of nididhyasa is left to the seeker now. You can't ask questions. In one shot he reeled out something which appeared completely unrelated and then put all of them into one shot and gave. This is a very nice piece actually. I thought I will just show you. This is another thing that you find. So, in this Upanishad, in this particular Bhrguvalli, we will actually see something similar. This will not be this deep, but we will see that. So, we will start with this introduction of what it is. Let's start the first Anuvaka of Bhrguvalli. So, let me first recite the Anuvaka. Bhrgurvaiva runihi varunam pitaramupasasara adihi bhagavo brahmheti tasma etat provacha annam pranam chakshushrotram manovacha miti tagumho vacha
Yatova imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisambishanti tad vijignasasva tad brumheti. Iti is the end of that. Tad brumha iti.
Actually, it ends there. Then satapo, now this Bhrigu has gone. Because he is not making sense of it. Satapo tapyata satapas taptva. Up to that is the first anuvaka. Tapo tapyata tapas taptva, we will leave it. We will take it to the second. Because it has a sort of a connection to it. So this is the first anuvaka of Bhrguvalli.
So Bhrigur vaivarunihi. Bhrigu vai. Vai is indeed. Vai is, you know, used as indeed.
It's indeclinable actually. He, why are all used in, why are used in Sanskrit?
Bhrguhu vai varunihi.
See, the word varuni, Sanskrit construction is so powerful. There is a taddita. In fact, in English also we use taddita. We say pranik. Pranik is actually taddita. Taddita means you take a word and twist the word to explain something related to the word. I am using a rough definition for taddita. In Sanskrit, words can be constructed in many ways, but the most powerful in Panini, lot of sutras are only 3, 4, 5 chapters, Ashtadhyayi is only for Taddita. What it does is, it takes a word and it wants to describe something pertaining to the word, it will do, by and large, it will do what is called Adi Vritti. The first Varuna will become Va. See, Va become Va, you see. Varuni it has become. Dasharathasya putraha. Dasharati. It's Adi Vriddhi. The Da will become Da.
Lavanasya Bhavaha Lavanya. Karuna Bhavaha Karunyam. All are Taddita. Ishwarasya Bhavaha Aishwaryam.
It's called Adi Vriddhi. E will become I. Vriddhi is A, I and O. Vriddhi Radhaich. That's actually the formula.
This is a very powerful construct. Lots of words. Vanaprastha we say. You know where Vanaprastha came? It describes a person who is Vanaprastha.
So Adi will become Vriddhina, Va will become Va. So Vanaprastha is not Vanaprastha.
Vane Prasthanam Karoti Yaha Saha Vanaprastha.
So this is a very powerful treatment. You take a word, twist it and describe something pertaining to the word, something else. So that's how the Varuni is coming. Varuni is Varunasya Apatyam Puman. The son, the progeny of Varuna is called Varuni. Bhrigu is actually the son of Varuna. That is what is being explained by that word Varuni.
Bhrigu is indeed Varuna's son. That's what it is saying. Bhrigurvai Varunihi.
That's how it starts. Now this Bhrigu, in fact in Bhagavad Gita chapter 10, Maharshinam Bhrigurakham, Krishna says, in those 72 manifestations that he gives, one example is among the Maharshis I am Bhrigu. Actually, there is a bit of a controversy or different, I wouldn't say controversy, two, three different ways of explaining. See, this Bhrigu people are saying is not that Bhrigu. See, first there were, you know, when the order of creation was there, when Hiranyagarbha created Manasaputras, one of them was Bhrigu. So, people say that is one Bhrigu. And the story goes that when this Daksha Yajna was happening, everybody was burnt, including Bhrigu. The big story behind that, you know, all that. So he was born again. He was born again as Varuna's son. So this is, I mean, this is a little bit of a history and story to it. But the Bhrigu is the son of Varuna. Okay. And he is, in fact, there are a lot of Veda mantras in which Bhrigu is there. Bhrigu and Angiras are very, very important in Brahmanas. First part of the Veda. So it's a well-known Rishi. It is talking about that. It's not clear whether this Bhrigu is the same as the other Bhrigu. We'll leave all that. Stories of that kind. Anyway.
One Bhrigu keeps Vishnu also.
Yeah.
It's
the other guy, I think. The other one, I think. In the Dashavatara, yeah. He's only one who kicked Vishnu and he's just... So that's the other story. Anyway. So,
Varunam Pitaram Upasasara.
So, he went to... The sasara is from sasara, sru gatav is the dhatu, sru gatav, it is in the second gana as well as third gana. Sru is the dhatu in gatyartha, moving, whenever you want to discuss, sarati, Sarati is there. Sasara is a narrative past. Like Babu, Sasara. So Pitaram, Upasasara. Upa is near. So the son goes near the father. So the first two lines are saying what? Bhrigu is the son of Varuna. He went near his father. So that's what the first two mantras are saying. Pitaram Upasasara. Varunam Pitaram Upasasara. Then comes, in fact, this is the interesting part. It looks like a father can actually teach a Brahma Vidya to the son. That is what this conversation is. So that is the level of knowledge and common part of the knowledge which was existing at least in a selected few. So the father is the guru for the son. There is a lot of traditions of that kind. Whereas today we are in a very different sort of a thing, you know, we can't get all these at a father-son level and so on. But anyway, so he goes to his father and Adihi Bhagavo Brahmheti. So Adihi, please make me known of, hey Bhagavan, there were a certain tradition, there were certain traditions about this Brahma Vidya. There are a few rules and certain traditions. If you look at other Upanishads, you will find it. There are certain, first of all, Brahma Vidya, this knowledge, Brahma Vidya meaning the knowledge of oneself. Knowledge of oneself can never be attained by reading books. It's impossible. The only way to try it is, to challenge it or otherwise, is rather than asking the question, you have to try it. And then see where it goes and so on. The first rule of Brahma Vidya is we should go to a guru. Because the guru is actually a catalyst, like a catalyst in a chemical process. He will not partake in the process, he can only accelerate the process. See, a catalyst never takes part in the chemical reaction. It is there to sort of speed it up, facilitate it and do it better. Guru's role is exactly that. Without that catalyst action, this process will never be efficient. So the first rule is that this knowledge of self-knowledge is always to be obtained in some form from a guru. So that is being indicated by saying, the father-son is a guru. Although there is a father-son, there is a guru-sishya relationship here. First rule. Second rule is there is a certain method of approaching. This Upanishad is not brought in all. Many of the Upanishads you will find. It will say vidivat upasannaha. In fact, this word comes in Mundaka Upanishad as well as in Prashna Upanishad. There is a certain way of approaching the guru. And there are certain, for example, samitapaneha. Having a set of sticks, the samit, which can be offered in a... there are many people have discussed this issue. This is although this appears like a figurative kind of a usage, people have discussed in good length as to what is the significance of that. That it has a propensity to melt completely in no time, which signifies something. So like that, so many things are. So samitapaneha. Then the guru, there are certain prescriptions. In fact, Bhagavad Gita says, tadviddi pranipateena pariprasneena seveya. All those are there. As far as the guru is concerned, univocally in all Upanishads, it says he must be a Shrotriya, he must be a Brahmanishta. One whose nishta is in Brahman. Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam Vidivat Upasannaha Samitapaneha. That's those prescriptions are all not here. But it is all understood. When you say that a person approaches as somebody for knowledge, there are certain prescribed ideas which are there. So anyway, so the father-son relationship transforms into a teacher-student relationship. And there is this one question he asked. Adihi Bhagavo Brahmheti. I would like to know what is this Brahman. Tasma in Sandhi, when you do the Sandhi Cheda, become Tasmai. Tasmai to him, Etat Provacha. The father said this. Etat Provacha, Prauvacha, Provacha. So the father, it's a narrative past. So father said like this. What did he say? He said, what is Brahman? See his answer. His answer is Annam. Annam pranam chakshushrotram manovachamiti. Brahman is nothing but annam pranam chakshuhu shrotram manaha and vak. Finished. I don't know what to do with this. This is the answer. He asked, what is Brahman? And the student asked, what is Brahman? The teacher says, oh, you want to know Brahman? Brahman is nothing but the six elements. Annam, food, okay, pranam, pranan, chakshuhu, okay, shrotram, manaha, vak, vachamiti. So he simply says, Varuna told, now the question is, what do you do? This is very characteristic of the learning teaching process. This is what I wanted to get at. This is the method. In fact, in Chandogya Upanishad, last chapter, I have several times I quoted that. Same thing. Prajapati and to Prajapati, Indra and Virochana goes. And Indra say, Prajapati says something, both are not able to make sense. The only problem is one person actually understood in a particular way, he got satisfied and went. Virochana understood it in one way and then went. But the culture and the practice at that time is, knowledge cannot be revealed just like that, because it will not even stay, it will not even get internalized. That is the idea. It is not, I want to play close to the chest, I don't make it available to you. Not like that. A foolproof method of getting knowledge is, we have to endure for it. We have to put our efforts towards it. So it will be always good artha. It will be anyartha or good artha. So here he is saying, what is Brahman, he is asking. So the answer he gives is annam pranam chakshu shrotram mano vachamiti. So it is up to him to now make sense of it. So that's what first he says. Annam pranam chakshu shrotram mano vachamiti. Then, because probably he is his son, he had a little more, I think, vatsalya. So he added one more. He added one more sentence, which also you need to sort of find out how to make sense of it. So the next thing he said, Tagumho vacha tam hi vacha. He told furthermore, he is again indeed, or you know, these are all the punch to carry the emphasis on its moving forward and so on. Tagum is tam. Tam hi vacha. To him he said again, the father said again. What did he say? Yatova imani. So he opened the clue a little bit. Rather than just leaving it at these six items. He thought, let me open the clue a little bit. So he says, Yatova imani bhutani jayante. That source, yataha, from that source, imani bhutani jayante, this whole living creatures found their origin. They came out from. They came out from that. Right? Yena jatani jivanti. This, those who took birth, lived for a certain time. Who sustained their living? Somebody sustained their living. And that somebody. Yena jatani jivanti. Yat pratyanti. Prati, you know, pratyanti. Abhisambishanti. Prati, yat prayanti, sorry. Yat prayanti abhisambishanti. Again it reaches back. It goes back. It goes back to the same source. Tadvijignyasasva. Understand that. Try to understand that. Tad brumheti. That is Brahman. So he opened the clue a little bit. Instead of leaving it with the first set of those six names merely, he said that primordial source from which this whole sakala jiva rashi, this jiva jagat, ishvara, everything came out, and which was sustained by that only, and into which all of them went finally, that is actually Brahman. Vijignyasasva, make an effort to, he never said that, he said make an effort to understand. Jignyasa is a desire to know. Knowing is different from desire to know. Without a desire to know, knowing is not possible. So the Sanskrit word is jignyasa. Like we say bubuksha. Desire to eat. Hunger is called bubuksha. Desire to drink is called pipasa. Thirst is called pipasa. Pipasa means what? There is a desire to drink. So like that. So jignyasa. So vijignyasa swa. Develop this desire to know this. I will tell only this much. You develop a desire to know what it is. That is what the father said, tad brumheti iti. So he, the iti, puts a full stop into the Varuna's description. So this is all he has said. So the first Anuvaka is the son goes to the father and asks, tell me what is Brahman. And father first gives an answer which looks so unconnected. Then again he tried and gave one more sentence which also one has to make sense of it, and then he leaves it at that. So rest of the five Anuvakas are the journey of the questioner. He never came and came back and asked a question. He came back and reported something, and the father said something again. So he went back. He never answered, but he said something, so he again went back. So the next five Anuvakas are the journey of a knowledge seeker on his own. That is the way to actually acquire knowledge. I believe even if you want to learn, in fact, we have our own experience. Good management is learned when we tried, not because we got a S grade in something, or financial management you never learned because we got a S grade. We tried. We hit our head onto it. We kept on sort of, making our own assumptions, going back and forth and all that. I think that is what is emphasized. A good way of, so the point I want to make is, if you want manana to happen, please don't ask questions. Preserve the question to yourself. Protect the question and find the knack of the question disappearing for whatever reasons I said. That's really good. That is what this Bhrguvalli is also showing us in terms of. Now, anyway, coming back to this. So he says, annam, pranam. So if you take annam, pranam and manas. So these three are related to annamaya kosha, pranamaya kosha and manomaya kosha. At least somewhere we can start sort of making some bridge. Because there was some argument which has gone. So maybe we'll have to go back to that and try to connect to it and say, is he meaning that? Why did he say that? So should we revisit Brahmananda Valli and then see that part of the story where what we thought as a Brahman became a kosha on a certain sound argument of logic. Atma, Anatma, Vichara and all those. So maybe these three are suggesting that. Now you have Sakshuhu and Shrotram and Vak. Now this Chakshu and Shrotram are sense organs. They are Jnanendriyas. And in all these texts, and also in any poetry also, there is a lot of interpretation involved. They will not put the whole list because they are under a constraint of so many things. So that's the job of the interpreter. So Sakshuhu Shrotram here basically says it is pointing to a set of Jnanendriyas, which includes three more. And Vak is actually the representative of the Karmendriya. So this Jnanendriya and Karmendriya together is the gateway of knowledge for any human being. So somewhere the Vijnanamaya Kosha is, these are the organs for Vijnanamaya Kosha. Gate of knowledge is these three. Jnanendriya, Karmendriya combination. Because Jnanendriya informs you something, Karmendriya is used to react to it and learn that. Again, all these happens. So, somewhere that is the nearest we can go up to from this cryptic sort of a definition. That is what one can do. Whereas this second definition is slightly better because one can, if you take a drop of water, a wavelet, a wave, and then one can understand that this wave, which had a temporarily an independent form, shape and name, nama rupa was there. It is called wave. Moment you say wave, you never think of Indian Ocean. Moment you say Indian Ocean, you never think of wave. Moment you say bubble, you don't think of ocean or wave. But all of them have come from a source called water. All of them have come from a source called water. So out of water came a wave. Because of water, it sustained its property of wave. Can you think of a wave without water? Can you think of a dress without, cotton. Tantu, the thread. Without a thread, how can you actually think of a dress? So out of thread came dress. Because of thread, the dress maintained its individuality, nama, rupa and all that. And back into the thread it went. You can sort of pull all the thread one out of the other. I am just hypothetically saying. You can pull all these thousand threads. Finally you get thread. The dress is disappeared. Now, dress may be a difficult example for us to follow in this particular case. Take a pot and clay. Out of clay came the pot. And can you think of a pot by removing, can you think of a clay pot after removing the clayness? Without a clayness, there is no clay pot. Without a plasticness, there is no plastic pot or a plastic mug. How can you think of a plastic mug without plastic? So if you, out of plastic came the mug, because of plastic the mug sustained and had its existence. One day you melt it, it goes back to plastic. So back into plastic it went. So that is what is being told. Yatova imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisham vishanti. This is a little manageable. It is basically saying that whatever, you know, take individuals. Individuals came out of something, individuals sustain out of something, and individuals have to go back to something. In fact, in Brahmananda Valli, we saw it in some detail. So that is what is being pointed here. So this Bhrguvalli is a classic ancient Indian tradition of teaching where you don't give an answer. You set the learner onto a path of contemplation. Take time. Virochana and Indra took 25 years. And then after 25 years, one of the dullest answer which Prajapati gave, and then Virochana was happy with that and went, Indra was not happy. He spent another 25 years, 24 years, 4 times 24 years, 96 years, then another 5 years at the end. After 101 years, he got his answer. He simply said, come, be here. For a lot of Vedantic classes I have seen, they say, come and sit. They don't say anything. They won't answer. So initially I used to think this looks, because we are trained to a certain paradigm. So I used to think, what is all these? These are all, waste of time, and why are we doing? But people have experienced. One of the Shishyas of Ramana Maharishi said, 14 years I was just sitting, doing nothing. I used to get very, first 5 years, he said, I was only irritated. So it took 5 years for me to get my Dhamma and Shama. That's a very valuable experience, huh? Valuable path in the journey. 5 years I had to run down my Dhamma and Shama. So he said, later he says the 15 years made a lot of sense. But I used to think these are all utter nonsense. But he said after 15 years, he started melting. Ramana Maharshi will not tell him anything. He'll just sit and then literally he'll languish, if you have to use a word like that. He was just languishing out of nothingness. He thought like that. But that 15 years, there was so much that happened. So the journey, so this kind of journey is very different. So some of these traditions are of that variety, which is what we are actually seeing here. So I think we will continue. This is just an opening to say that the father-son conversation started. Father gave a very cryptic and a sort of an answer. So now the son has to figure out what to do. So that's how it is. We will continue to the next class. Sridhar Elli City has brought some Tirupati Prasada, please. Partake the prasada itself. Thank you.